Nessa.
Yes, Nessa, give thanks. You know, and a lot of things you're going to bring to the people this afternoon with your special guest.
Yes, I am. Today we're going to be discussing the power of unity. And I've also got two special guests with me, going by the name of, you want to introduce yourself?
Dahlia the Poet from Detroit, USA.
7 Mile Moogs from Detroit, USA.
Yeah, so we've got our American family in the building today. So make sure you tune in and also call in to ask some questions. And yeah, just support the movement, man.
Man, I love you, man. Scripts, Shooky Sosa, Narco, Modulation, Razor, Tevin J, Cameron Uzorka, Henry D, Jordan, DJ Nels, Mims, Ghetto Reps, Mantis 40 Winks, all my G's, all my certified spitters. Yo. Fallen angels and lost souls, real soldiers doing real time, single mothers who lost hope, verbal lies to our only child that daddy's fine, he'll be home soon, it's a hard life but we fight plies, wrong way about to take flight, it's a true story and I can't lie, I've been doing this since mad young and I'll be doing this till I'm mad old, and if you don't like me it's fuck you, excuse my French, I'm in beast mode, I see your call but won't pick my phone, that's an indication, leave me alone, you wanna check my progress, that's why you call me, don't invite me studio to video shoots, I don't beg friend, got my own G's, I couldn't care less if you're famous. Got a fan base that's slowly growing, don't call them fans, they're family. Based in Morley's at Norwood Junction, had chicken wings with Scripps and Jordan. And after recording residence, Scripps told me the tune was a problem. 4 months later, we're shutting down shows, it's a madness all around London. Hashtag that's murky, and a storm be where my G's be. Cause in due time, we'll be raining hard like Ramesses, I guarantee. Some of my niggas real Christians, some of my niggas straight criminals. Some of my niggas all tied up and they're backing me to the graveyard. See what keeps me spitting is the passion for rapping and rap addicts say I'm the one. Can't wait till I bust like a gun and turn all my haters to conflict the fans who love me but can't chat cause they used to cuss me. When I rap they listen, connect with a passionate message, won't stop till I get it. I'm hot like a kettle, but an ashes a rebel. I'm sick, need a medic, any beat I can flip it. I'm fly like a comic, take flight like a rocket. My young G might pop it, they're robbing in Gotham, the feds always watching. Hey, boy Nash, nah.
Big up to boy Nash,
I'm known to
speak. Keeping it real on this track.
Their own tracks like frisbees, born in Mitcham, moved to Ghana cause I like manners, back to Clapham to continue rapping. Rest in peace, Lukey. Paying tribute to a real G. I don't know, but
gonna be playing some nice music today for you.
This pilgrimage, hand on my heart, I pray with yours.
Lightning music. Line, eh?
Niggas chit chat behind my back, but to my face, it's all high, man.
We're also gonna have some spoken words by Dahlia the Poet as well.
So it's a snip snip, and I'm cutting off all them bad vibes. Jealous brethren who hate your growth at first chance will dash you off the boat. Build your buzz, get your hype, pay for studio, do your videos, promoters book you for a big show and they won't even pay for your travel. Meanwhile they're selling out tickets, how we grow if the artist is starving. I've been slept on like a bedspread for too long, how long till I go pro? I'm the boy Nash, they can't clone me, I'm like an OG. Mr. Wade, it be too much, it's gonna boy, it be too much. Rapping there, me fan of qua Munja, I mean, I'm a dark cry. Mr. Wade, it be too much. This Ghana boy, it be too much. Rapping there, me fan of qua Munja, I mean, I'm a dark cry.
Cry tears in my cup of Hennessy for these fucked up memories. Cut niggas off for them bad vibes and them fucked up energies. Shout to the niggas that don't like me. Shout out to the ones that are repping me. Shout out to the niggas that tried to finesse me, but I'm too plugged in mentally. Heard that waste man taking shots, but he's just a wannabe.
Okay, so that was Boy Nash on my garden too.
That was awesome.
It was.
Shout out to Boy
Shout
Nash.
Shout out to Boy Nash that one
was,
time.
That was nice.
Yeah, he's talking about single mothers. Talking about a lot of things on that track, so it's good. It's bringing awareness to the new minds, the young generation. Definitely.
The minds held captive.
So what we're going to be talking about today is unity. Well, that's our subject, unity. And actually, I was inspired by my two Detroit friends that are here today. Because they made me realize how much, or should I say, how important it is to have unity, to be, you know, close with your family, friends, you know, just for support. like, everyone in this life needs support, and a lot of people are going through struggles right now and they don't have anyone around them. So I think it's really important that we all stick together and we come together for the betterment of humanity. And so, yeah, this is the subject that we're going to be talking about today. Now, there's a question I want to just throw out there out of the blue. How important it is for black people to unite?
I mean, it's more than important. It's vital. You know, in a society where we're constantly facing different, you know, forms of systematic racism, and even in our own neighborhoods, a self-inflicted genocide, I think it's vital for, you know, I don't want to say humanity because we're more than human, but it's vital for our existence. You know, unifying is not simple. It's not. And, you know, we can talk about generations of things that continue to tear us apart, and that's just going to go in circles. It's more of, honestly, just retraining the mind completely. Everything we've been taught to think, believe, to feel.
Yeah.
You know, everything that we think may be morally right or wrong, we really need to just look at beneath the surface and just discover who we are as a people. See, I know in a big culture shock for me, where I come from in Detroit, you know, a lot of black Americans do not know where they come from. So when I get here and I'm in the UK, I'm walking around London, I'm walking around these different cities, I see these...
So many
people, black faces from everywhere. Everyone knows where their family comes from.
Yeah.
It was a proud moment, but it also hurt because I didn't know how to identify myself.
Yeah,
because definitely. In America, a lot of black people can't even figure out where their family came from due to slavery. You know, so it's like you have a lot of people with a low self-esteem. They're running around, they're angry, they don't even know who they are, so they're constantly trying to emulate and assimilate into other cultures. So how can you unify people that don't know who they are?
Yeah, that's a good question.
It doesn't make any sense. Yeah. It's almost like you're trying to, how can I say it? It's almost like you're going to keep making left turns going in circles thinking that eventually you're going to go right.
Yeah.
It's almost like insanity. Yes. Yeah. And that's why we keep passing it off generation to generation to generation. And we can't blame everything on the system. At some point, we have to take responsibility.
Yeah.
We have to, you know, we have to make sure that the buck stops with us. With every ear that's listening, you have to put it in your mind, if you haven't taken the steps already, to reevaluate your life and yourself, that, you know, the buck is going to stop with me, and I'm going to make sure that my seed, and I'm going to make sure that any other kids and children, anybody else I'm around, that I'm going to make sure that I put forth the effort to raise them up in the right ideals of how to unify with, you know, their other relatives and the village, the black people.
What's Detroit like? Is your community quite together? Like, do you stick together, or would you say it's quite separated?
It's very separated. I'm from the west side of Detroit. It's like 7 Mile, Wyoming area. And you got the east side versus the west side. You got light skin versus dark skin. You got all these different separations. It's like, for no reason, though. You know what I'm saying? It's because maybe social media plays a big part of it, but it's just retarded. It's, you know, we have to definitely do better and get it together, because where I'm from, I just lost a homeboy yesterday due to some you know, stuff that just could have been avoided. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But people just don't know how to sit down and talk to other people. You know what I'm saying? It's a lot of stuff that can end if you could just sit down and talk to somebody. You know what I'm saying? But people don't know how to talk it out, you know? It's just of a misunderstanding. I had a homeboy who, they got to an argument with each other. Both of them had guns. But my brother, he decided not to even, you know, participate in that type of action. So he decided to just leave it alone. which is a surprise. And both of them decided, you know, you say, you know what, we're both bigger than this. But we, for some reason, a lot of people can't do that where I'm from. And
yeah. But you know what I think? How can we exchange and dialogue when we have not been taught properly how to communicate? When we, you know, have been taught to speak with action, to shoot first and ask questions later. How can we sit down and have a dialogue like men and women to resolve any issues if in our own homes, you know, we're seeing our mamas and aunties fighting in the street and not talking? If we're seeing these things and we're not being taught how to have this type of dialogue with one another to build, how, I guess my question would be, how can we resolve things in other ways and unify if we aren't even properly educated on how to communicate?
No, definitely, man. And I think that's a big issue right now, because it's like, how do we move on from slavery to what's going on now? Because in a way, we are still kind of enslaved mentally and physically. So it's like, there's so many obstacles that we have to, you know, jump over to in order for us to reach that higher heights, the higher heights that we need to be as human beings, not even just black or white, as normal human beings living on this earth.
I think when people fail to realize, what I see a lot, I don't know if it happens here, but what I see a lot in America, it's truly not about black and white. Mm. It is about rich and poor and about keeping people separated.
Right.
Because I see a lot, some of the most racist people are poor white people. Mm. I've noticed it. And poor black people. Because when I lived in the South, I lived in Louisiana for some time, and that was the most racism I've ever seen coming from black people. Mm. But I understood it because of the things that they faced living in the South and racism inflicted on them from white people. Yeah. But what I've come to realize is, when we start realizing that it's not really about black and white, it's about separation, it's about rich and poor and wealthy, because wealthy is different than being rich. Mm. That's where it boils down to, is that when you have control over resources and you want to keep individuals from coming together and overthrowing your power, the best way to do that is to keep everyone separate, is to create this pseudo beef with one another where everybody's constantly at each other's throats instead of coming together and saying, you know what, we won't take this, we won't conform to this, we will rise above this, and your time is up. You know, but until people enlighten themselves and get to that certain level where they can do it on their own, you know, and realize that, hey, we don't need this, we're not going to take this, it's just going to continue to happen. And the sad thing that I see about black people more than anything is that we continue to play the blame game. We can't blame slavery no more. We can't, because we're not physically slaves.
Yeah.
And mentally, you're in slavery only because you choose not to think outside the box.
Right. Yeah.
You know, I seen the coolest video on the internet that made so much sense. It said that this is proof that limits only exist in the mind, and they had an ant. It's the serious. It's so serious. Video. It's true, but it was incredible. It was mind blowing. An ant on white paper.
Yeah.
He was crawling around just as free as could be. They took an ink pen, drew a circle around the ant, and then all of a sudden, there were limits. He could have easily walked right over that line and still been free.
Yeah, no, definitely.
But because his mind told him that he was trapped, he just continued to run in circles. And I feel like that's what our people are doing.
So it's an awareness issue. It's
absolutely.
Awareness, absolutely. Self-confidence, all that stuff. Because if people were more aware of what they were doing, and, you know, the effects that it's having around them, then they will be more conscious.
Absolutely.
And that's the problem. We don't have a lot of conscious people.
Bahaha. Here's my question for you, Nessa. Because, you know, you're a very, very bright woman. And I know that, you know, this... What bothers me... Here's my question. How can a conscious person, an enlightened person, how can they get through to someone that is
brain dead and blind. Oh my gosh. How?
That's a good question.
How can we do that?
That is
how
a very can we good do question. That?
How can we reach this person?
Okay, you know what? Actually, I spoke to Cameron about this when we met up the other day, and you guys were like behind us, but we were speaking about Farrakhan, and we were speaking about, well, he was given an example, you know, what he would say to a friend, you know, if they're having an argument. Like, he would ask an open question, because if he's giving his friend advice and that friend's not hearing it, he'll just ask him an open question to make him, you know, figure it out for himself and think. But what I said to him was, actually, I feel like there needs to be some enforcement, because when I was pregnant with my first daughter, I was vulnerable, but if I didn't hear Farrakhan, the first lecture I heard from Farrakhan was how to give birth to a god. Now, if I didn't hear that lecture, if it wasn't forced upon me like the way it was, I wouldn't have changed in my life. But it's like, people don't want to be forced upon.
No.
They want to be forced upon with the media and all that stuff. They want the media to control them. But if someone's trying to tell them something, it's like they're either stubborn, they don't want to listen, they just want to do their own thing. And that's the problem. Like, we need to enforce it upon our people, because what's wrong with forcing something up onto someone if it's positive? If it's positive, why can't we enforce? You know, if the media is enforcing negativity on our children, we can enforce positivity on our people, for sure. Even if it means just going out, you know, talking to criminals or whoever, you know, that's lost in the world, we can go and tell them the right knowledge and tell them, look, what you're doing right now, you shouldn't be doing. You know, like, I know it's a bit, you know, too much, but that's the only way you can do it. You have to force it up onto them. And if you've got that intuitive feeling that, you know, you need to tell someone something, like when you were telling me those things that you were telling me,
mm-hmm.
like, that was from God, like, that was from within, you know. Mm-hmm. And it's like, if you're having a conversation with someone and you feel like they're going down the wrong path, don't be afraid to tell them. Like, if your spirit is telling you, tell this person something, tell them, because maybe in that moment they needed to hear it. And you have to enforce it onto our people, because, as you said, we're brain dead. A lot of us, we're just brain dead.
You know what it really boils down to?
Mm.
Everything that you said is beautiful, but it's definitely a magnificent feat. You know, what it is it's all about presentation.
Right.
Because the same way that you deliver a message to me,
mm.
you can't deliver it to the next person. One, because we all learn differently.
Mm.
We receive information differently.
Mm.
We have all these different receptors in our brains that, you know, calculate what we're seeing, what we're thinking, what we're feeling. Our brain is constantly defining something.
Yeah.
And if we've been taught for our brains to receive information one way,
mm.
it's hard for someone to come and tell you need to receive it this way.
That's true.
It's very, very difficult.
That is true.
That's just like you being learned, like you've been taught how to ride a bike a certain way, and then they're going to tell you have to stand up and pedal backwards. That's what it's like. That's the perfect metaphor for it.
Mm.
And so here, for example, my conscious art is 100% accepted and not judged. I have not had any issues.
Mm.
In Detroit, I had to fight for 3 years to get my music heard.
Right.
I had to snatch mics and ciphers because I was not respected and I was considered backpack.
Mm.
So what I had to do, and I love to use Kendrick Lamar as a perfect example, because his first album was loaded with a lot of messages, but they were hidden to groovable tunes. So a lot of people thought that he just glorified gang life and thought that he just glorified this and glorified that. But he has songs speaking out about alcoholism in his family.
Yeah.
He has songs speaking out about being a lost youth in Compton and what he thought and felt and what he believed at that time was to be true.
Mm.
But then when he came out, and everybody loved that album, by the way,
mm.
but then when he came out with To Pimp a Butterfly, it was judged. It was like a lot of black people. I seen more white people celebrating To Pimp a Butterfly than black people, because black people felt like it was too messagey or the tunes wasn't something they could really ride to or party to. But I felt like his method worked. because mm-hmm. his method got him into mainstream audiences. Yeah. And then he gave them what they needed. He gave them what they thought they wanted, and then he turned around and gave them what they needed. And I actually had to do the same thing in Detroit. A lot of my music didn't contain a lot of cursing. It was very direct in the messages. Mm. And then when I went to record again, I got tired of being disrespected.
Yeah.
I got tired of my point not getting across. So, as Moogs like to say, what's the metaphor that you like to use?
Give them the medicine with the sugar. The medicine with the ice cream.
Yeah, so I had to make sure I made them a nice, big, beautiful sundae, just as ignorant as they think they like it.
Yeah.
But I made sure that the medicine was the fudge topping. So I put all my same messages within the music,
right.
But I picked beats that... It had the sound. It had a higher frequency. It made them feel the same feelings that they felt when they heard a lot of the unconscious music.
Right, yeah.
So I would still send those same messages, but I came so direct and so aggressive.
But do you think that because you're not giving it the full wave of what it should be, that people will still stay asleep?
That's no, because the message is clear. Okay. It's not hidden. It's just dressed prettier.
Okay.
I'm going to tell you the truth. We're going to be honest. If you're talking to a person that, I like to speak in metaphors and different anecdotes and things to help people feel what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. So, for example, if you're speaking to an athlete or a soldier, they're used to people yelling at them, mm-hmm. being direct, being hard with them. And then you come and you deliver a message meek and silent. They may not receive it. Yeah. So if I'm speaking to gangsters in the hood, or I'm speaking to females that have never respected or loved themselves a day in their life, I have to come a certain way to them with the message. You can't deliver the message the same way. Mm-hmm. You can't. The message is there, but it's aggressive.
Yeah.
See, before my message was more soulful, and I reached a lot of people, but not the people that I wanted to reach. That's just like the method with churches. No, I tell people all the time, it's cool to build in fellowship with people in the church, but that's organized. The people that you want to reach and the people that you want to help are not sitting in the church.
Mm.
They're outside.
Yeah.
The people that I want to reach are the people that are not in the conscious community.
Yeah.
Because if I'm just keep making music just for the conscious community, then I'm constantly preaching to the choir. Constantly. They're not the people that need to wake up. So the people that need to wake up are out there.
Raising them out of that vibration.
I'm raising them from the dead.
Yeah, to higher. Yeah, that's difficult, man.
It is.
Yeah, it's...
Like I said, for example, I have a song. I don't know if I'm allowed to curse or not, so I won't. But I have a song where I say it's something that a lot of women go through, a lot of discrimination, you know, in the rap community. And they have to be over-sexualized, and they have to be homosexual or bisexual, or they have to talk about gangbanging. When a lot of the females that I see speak about these things, their life does not resemble that at all.
Yeah.
But this is what they have to do to get popular.
Mm.
And I'm not going to do that, and I'm not willing to do that. I have a song called Queen MC where the opening line is, I was a bitch then, but I'm a queen now. My crown is up, and my bows are down, and my fists are tight, and I'm stronger now.
Yeah.
That's because I want people to know, yes, I came from that bad bitch mentality. I thought that was okay, because that is what I learned. That is what men consider beautiful, because I didn't feel beautiful in my natural hair. I didn't feel beautiful in my brown skin.
Can I just ask you, what changed you? What changed your path?
Because I was not happy.
Okay.
When you get tired, that's when you love yourself, you accept yourself, and then when you see the truth, you want others to see it too.
Yeah.
The only way we can unify is to know who we are, to love ourselves, to love our brothers and sisters, and that we all take this journey and grow together. We don't love ourselves. We don't listen to music that represents a love for ourselves and our culture.
Mm.
We don't behave in that way. We don't even greet each other in that way. Here, I've gotten a lot of love. I don't know if it's because I'm American or not. I can't say.
Mm.
But I know in my city, I held a door open for a young lady one time.
Yeah.
And I looked back to make sure she grabbed the door because I let it go and I thought it was going to close on her. Mm. And when I looked back to grab the door to make sure she got it, she looked at me and she called me out of my name because she thought I looked at her funny. If we can't even have encounters, pleasant encounters with one another, and we're constantly fighting one another, how do you unify from that?
Yeah, and that's the issue that we're facing. If anybody wants to call in, call 07923-334-515 and we'll take your questions. You're tuning into Galaxy Afiwi radio station, the only de-brainwashing station, and we'll be back soon speaking more about unity and how we're going to be able to rise the dead out of this, you know, mentality, the state that they're in right now. I'm also going to play a song for you right now by Modulation, and it's called Black.
People, please wake up out there.
Yeah, definitely, man. It's time. It's time to rise.
If I die.
What is the name of the color where you're so proud to be and not be ashamed? Every time we bend our backs and not fucking slack when we're in this game.
Having a bit of technical issues.
Like to judge you because they only see one thing. A real king is so proud to have this queen because we can all see she is. Every single man them out here is so strong and tough because you're. We keep it 124/7 non-stop. That's why we're. Ladies, remember one thing. You are beautiful inside and out because you're. Don't separate yourself from a dark skin to a light skin. Fuck that. Remain. Don't make no more excuses of being a mixed race. To us, you're black. Not everyone is a stereotype or a shame.
You like that one?
Yeah, listen, man. You have to check what the youth them are saying. No swearing. I can't have no swearing on the airwaves. So the music I come, you know what I say? You know what I'm saying? What's my brother name? What's your name?
Modulation.
Oh, Mugs. Mugs from Detroit. So you're a rapper. So when you spit now, do you swear? Yes, I know. And when you do your poetry, do you swear?
Color where you're so proud to be and not be ashamed.
Right, for different audiences.
Yeah.
Yeah, I perform in front of a lot of different audiences, so sometimes our pieces will swear, sometimes I don't. Mm-hmm. It just depends on the message and the crowd.
Okay.
What do you say about that, Nessa?
I think that's beautiful.
Everything gone here. Well, no, hold on. No, it's all right. It's all right. Everything's all right. Yeah? All right. We're going to get the things black on track again. Go ahead, Nessa.
Okay. So I think it's beautiful when artists, you know, don't put any swearing in the music. Just try and keep it as clean as possible because, you know, we have children that are growing up and they're listening to your music and they're going to be inspired by you. And last thing you want is your three-year-old daughter running around saying, you know, what's those songs, the twerking songs. I can't even think of one.
I don't allow my kids to listen to children.
You know, we do not address our children
children.
This is a deep brainwashing station. There's nothing like this in the world, Aya. Because where we are, we're in an institution, and most of us are institutionalized.
Yes.
So we need to reclaim our Africanness.
Yes.
I think that's the best thing we can do.
That's right.
I've actually never liked that word, kids.
No,
as well,
it's like so. I know what it is, but what it is, it's a habit.
It's a hard habit.
It is to be
broken. Will it be broken?
It will be broken.
Because you got the words that is spoken.
Yes. Thank you.
Definitely.
It is. It's just like with me, and you know that. Not negas,
yeah,
but the N word.
Yeah.
You know, I was just speaking about that. It's like, it's difficult because, like I said, I used to be a certain kind of way.
Mm.
And the transition the last 3 years is a hard road to go down. It's difficult.
Yeah.
Because I was that girl that I talk about in my poetry. I was that girl that I talk about in my songs.
But you're transforming, which is beautiful.
I'm working on it. I know what feels right and what doesn't feel right.
We got a live caller here.
Oh, okay.
Greetings. Greetings, family. All on the family. All the lines, the family. All the lines there. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. All the lines, the family. We all link up. We all link up. Yeah. Respect to taking things to another level. Galaxy Radio. Greetings, family.
Greetings.
Hello?
Hello, greetings.
Greetings, greetings, greetings. What's your name?
It's a very bad line, darling, but I just wanted to congratulate the sisters and yourself on the panel in regards to where they're coming from.
Okay, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
She reminds me a lot of what Tupac was doing because he was trying to unify our people on the same path. Would she agree with me?
So she reminds you of Tupac, what Tupac was doing.
In what she's doing,
yeah.
I'm saying she reminds me, her pride reminds me of the way Tupac was trying to rally the troops, both male and female, to get us out of the mental gutter, which we, some of us are still in today. So that's why I applaud her.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much.
But, you know, for me, it's not about celebration, family. What it is what would make me happy is to just to feel good vibes every time I walk in a room. You know, when I walk in a room with black people, you know, sometimes I get nervous. When I walk in a black in a room where there's a mixed audience, you know, that's when I get happy. I get happy to see people blended together, to be honest. I really do. When I see a room full of black people, the only reason why I get nervous is because I don't know if everyone thinks like me or thinks higher than me. You know, I want to feel good vibrations, high vibrations everywhere that I go. Yeah. But if I walk in a room and I don't think that everyone is on the same wavelength, that's when I get nervous. You know, I want everyone to be on the same page and realize that a lot of these institutions, these governments, and the way that they do things, they're put into place to control us and to keep us from unifying. You know, a lot of things really do boil down to just the systematics of it all. And for me, I look at it as, you know, yeah, you got all these laws and different rules that are put into place. I get all of that. That's cool. Okay. But anytime your laws and your beliefs that you push on to your nations, anytime that keeps us oppressed mentally, anytime that redlines us into neighborhoods where we have to live poorly and it seems like there is no way for us to overcome that, anytime it seems like we're being sentenced like some type of prison sentence to live in poor or to constantly have to worry about, out here you got to worry about being stabbed, where I live you got to worry about being shot. So I look at it as we got to constantly live in these conditions. And a lot of these people are only angry because they're poor.
Exactly.
And they don't have resources. My son, his teacher stopped giving him homework maybe 2 weeks before school was even out. That's a no-no. He continued to get homework every day. We have to educate our children ourselves in the way that we want things to be. That's how we create unity.
We got a live caller. Yeah, we've got a live caller coming. Greetings.
Bear with us, caller.
Just a minute. Hello?
Yes, family. We're there, family. We're there. Yes, Nessa, you're going good.
Thank you. Yes, so.
Yes, indeed.
We've got another call.
With pleasure and humiliating, indeed.
Easy, family. Welcome yourself. Here we are. You got the platform. Greetings.
Yeah, I asked you if Galaxy Radio get pleasure and humiliating people, you know?
Get pleasure in.
What you want to say to the youths? What you want to say?
No, me ask the if when I get pleasure and humiliating people.
Who you talking to?
You see, when the people them are called children, kids, and them referring to one another as guys, you need to put a sign in at the studio roster that every guest you make that be clear to them before them utter the sound and you try correct.
Yeah, I will do that, family. I will do that.
Blessed Lord. Yes.
You know, I'm not more for say.
No, because we talk this morning, I'm the other man just with that talk, I'm behind him, you know, so I'm not really not the vibe. You know, I never really tune into
okay, give thanks.
Program the beginning, because I just have to put change all my number and thing, you know, because of different thing, you know, so I don't depend the you call it now, the live where they are, them depend to give any reason, you know.
You hear that, Nessa?
At the moment.
I hear you, so no worries. Thanks for calling in. Okay, so kids, we need to avoid that word in the future.
Indeed. Like I said, I'm a work in progress.
Yeah. We all are.
But at the end of the day, what I want to ask is the listeners to judge me not.
Exactly.
Because I am making attempts. I'm not trying, because to try sounds like a weak word, but I am actually making attempts.
Yeah.
And I can tell you, honestly, where I'm from, I'm probably far ahead of a few people, to be honest. You know, it is what it is. And I'm learning a lot while I'm here.
All right. Another caller. Greetings.
Yeah, greetings, brethren. Yeah, my name is Tony, right? I've been listening to you guests in this studio, and I can't believe what I'm hearing, yeah? I decry everything that one of your particular guests saying, that she feels a bit threatened when she walks into a room with all black people.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of talk is that? Right now in Europe today, as I speak, there is so much anti-immigrant sentiment going around, right? The whole world has changed to the right, okay? And before we start getting together and support our one another in all its forms, right? We are talking absolute trash. Come on, man.
Thank you so much for that. But what I want you to understand, brother, this is what I want you to understand. Where I come from, a room full of black people get together, people die. I'm not saying that all black people are bad. I love my people. But what I'm saying is, culturally, where I come from, I don't know if you've ever been to the States. I don't know if you've ever been to Detroit. This is why I ask for people not to judge me. Our experiences in life are all different. It would be completely asinine for us to assume that everybody's experiences are the same. But from where I come from, I never said I don't like being in a room full of black people. I said it makes me nervous because a lot of people where I come from, they don't get along, and it saddens me. I would love to see more of us come together. Every time I get around people, I have to be a peacemaker. I have to stop fights. I have to talk to people and get people to understand like it's all love.
Okay, the call's been disconnected. Anyways, okay. We're about to play a track now. You know, we had a few technical difficulties earlier, so we're sorry about that. And this is Modulation, and it's called Black. We'll be right back.
What is the name of the color we are so proud to be and not be ashamed? Black. Every time we bend our backs and not fucking slack when we're in this game. Black.
Here we go again. I better you play this one. Let me take full control this afternoon. This one is a junior gang. I better we take full control. The most royal there, family. Don't worry yourself. You know, give the youths a stage and a platform. You know what I say? Hold on it. Go on, Santa. Hold on, the family. Soon come.
No, just with what our sister was saying, and I really have to applaud her in the honesty, because Neely Fuller Jr. says that about us as a people in terms of, you know, when he says about white supremacy and the sort of menticide, yeah, going through the Mongomese, and how we actually relate to each other, is that even when you see a group of people who are of your own, you know, color. You have an apprehension, you know, and this is something that is sort of hardwired into us, you know, to have that fear factor, you know, we're up to no good. We sort of think the same about ourselves. So our sister said it quite correctly when she said, you know, I don't know what the mindset is, you know, in the room. And this is sometimes how we feel when we're just walking in our neighborhoods. I'm using the American vernacular, our neighborhoods or our streets or our estates, you know, our local communities. And we see a group of people and we may even see a group of young person, even as old as I am. I may be a little bit apprehensive. What are they up to? They got their trousers down there and I'm following the profile. So we're not saying we have a hate of ourselves. We're really being honest, and I think we need to be honest in how we actually feel about ourselves at time in the community. So you're on point, my sister, and I understand what the caller might have heard.
Right.
You know what I mean?
That's why I wanted to clarify that.
I heard you first time, though.
I want people to understand that I am, excuse me, I want people to understand that I am as 100% pro-black as it get, but just being pro-black does not mean that you are anti anything else.
But being as you're saying, pro-black is about the awareness of all of us as a people.
Yes.
And if we say that we're going through trauma, post-traumatic slave syndrome, if we're going through the mental sides and stuff like that, there are casualties out here, you know, and we're going to face them. Crackheads, you know, drug users, you know, mental health. It's all in our community. So I understand what you're saying, and I don't business up to the biggest gangster out there has the same feeling when he has to go into a club or, you know, and this is how it's getting. So I do appreciate love what you're saying.
And that's one reason why half of them are, you know, carrying weapons, because they have those thoughts. Because if they didn't need to protect, if they didn't feel that they needed to protect themselves, why would they carry weapons?
I mean, and what we're also highlighting is, why have we got this big fear of ourselves? Why is it that we've become the enemy within ourselves, you know? And that's part of the reparation and the healing that we need to be looking at.
How do
at.
We, and that will go back to my original question to Nessa. How can a conscious person, an enlightened person, can they speak
to
someone
all right, do you know what?
That is not of that same cloth? How can I or you or anyone in this room convince anyone to do, think, feel, believe anything differently?
It's like like everything's manifesting right now.
Yeah.
So let's take a break. We're gonna play Damian Marley now, and we'll be right back, you know, exploring this question. That's crazy.
Yo, me tell them caution when you see lion pan patrol. We looking teach you could have be the richest also. With your fortune, your money, your platinum and gold. Can't buy people life, you can't save people soul. Slaughter when boy I stop the cash flow. And I live comfortable while resentment a grow. Yo, I touch a the less fortunate I die slow. Oh, you feel reap wealth when I beard get you so. So the papa doesn't have a cash bill foul. And can't buy the knowledge where the rich man know. Now look after his family. In a resumble house all. But when him get up and decide to roll with his scotcher, real fire touch, real fire sparker. When the fire start, well not even water we quench. When the river then flow, put out this fire when it turn and start glow. Well when the Buddha do hungry belly stop fear, and decide we take it from all who not share. And the man paro can kick off anywhere. Cause hungry no business a whole life a steer. And when the Buddha do hunger keep conference, and make criminal and police turn friend. And this life we take it from all who not send. Now me tell them warning, listen up if you have ears to hear. Do not make hungry belly turn in a war engineer. And a trespass and mother up and pop at them beer. When he dirty get tough and everything is disappear. Warning, talk up if you have mouth to talk. And not speak up and get to you then be off. Cause them a play like a dummy and them not pay the staff. And I make the most nice them hear them front door kick off. Warning, look out all who have eyes to see. And still a play blind like injustice no real. Member hungry no have mercy pan battlefield. Man we eat your food faster than 10 Navy Seal. So caution, have your white collar extortion. You dirty politician and your tricks are on the youth them in a half. And smoke your cigar and a laugh and think you so smart and sadist. Yo, well about them who that do hungry belly stop fear. And this life we take it from all who not share. And the one man borrow can kick off anywhere. Cause hungry no business a whole life a spare. And when them who that do hunger keep conference,
and make criminal and police turn friend. And this side we take it from all who not send. Yo, me tell them action, always louder than words. And no school now below to the money transferred. You too greedy, you don't even left a one turn. Did he need you pen up and gather like herd? Option, scarce when it come on to job. Man can't find a work until them go road go rap. You a try safe face, but it done gone bad. Roots a gamble, them life raise them living standard. And that's a sign that unless you're being kind, one day you may find that you cannot stop the crime. Your system designed that stone it is the hill them can't climb. Even if them work a lifetime, them can't gain no traction. Can't find no satisfaction. Election is just a distraction. Write it in a caption. Caution, warning to all who think hunger can't jump your wall. Yo, well, when them would that do hungry belly stop fear. And this life we take it from all who not share. And when man parro can kick off anywhere. Cause hungry no business, a whole life a spare. And when them would that do hunger keep conference. And make criminal and police turn friend. And this life we take it from all who not send.
Beautiful Damian Marley for your ears. Okay, so now the energy's calmed down a little bit now. We're going to go back into the topic.
Well, you want to know something? Unity. I want to... Oh, we got a caller.
Somebody calling.
Yay, more callers. Callers are fun.
We've got some chronics coming up later.
Yeah, I'm going to tell you this, I just wanted to say one thing. The energy has never stopped being calm because I have peace within myself. Everybody may not agree with things. Definitely.
Yeah. Kind of like the callers, the calls that came through, you know, kind of shook up the energy a little bit. I think with the, because what you were saying, the question that you asked, I think definitely manifested earlier. Okay, so we've got a caller on the line now.
Yes, good evening now.
Good evening.
Good afternoon.
Yeah.
Yeah, can I have the names of the people in the studio, the young people?
Okay, so my name's Nessa.
My name is Dahlia, the poet from Detroit.
Who's the poet, sorry?
Dahlia, like the flower.
Dahlia.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yep, Dahlia. Yes, Dahlia. Good afternoon to you.
Greetings to you.
Welcome to the UK. Welcome to Galaxy as well.
Thank you. It's lovely.
And yeah, man. So it's just two of you, Nessa and Dahlia.
No, it's Nessa, Dahlia, and Moogs.
Yeah. Who?
Moogs. Where you at?
Moogs.
He's operating.
he's busy right now with the camera.
His name is Moo. Anyway, Moo.
Moogs. M double O G S
Z
Z Z Z.
Okay, Moose.
Yeah, that's it.
Sir.
I get you. All right. My name's Brother Nick.
Hi, Brother Nick.
Yeah, man, rise up. And I also write poetry as well. Yeah.
Nice.
Okay. Everybody cool. knows me write poetry as well. I agree with you when you said yeah. I think it's Dahlia said that she was talking about the Nation of Islam.
I know.
You know, they are the first. Really organization that I really did hear, you know, when they were saying things like how to eat to live, stop the killing, where they gathered the popular hip hop artists who the gangs from the east, north, south and west of America and Mexico and further on look up to, you know, and you got them together and, you know, in unison, you know,
yeah,
the young people. And you also got all different kind of people from all different kind of backgrounds. You know, the gangster, when there was gangster and all this thing, they turned their life around.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, so, you know, I say yes to that. You know, I mean, good thing like that. Yes. You know, they did some great works in the community. And even the UK representative, Hillary Muhammad, is like going into the communities to talk to the gangs over here.
Yeah, he's beautiful.
And,
yeah.
Yeah. And they also helped us to understand psychological, you know, damages that we're going through as a people as well. They were always on point with their research, you know. So I would say yes, that's great. Has any of the sisters heard of something that's going on Sunday called How Do We Deal With Self-Hatred? and it's going to be and Galaxy Radio's in conjunction with it, and it's going to be on Sunday, and it's from 5 o'clock, I think.
Okay.
Bernie Grant Center in Tottenham. Yeah.
Okay.
Have you ever heard of that? What's going on?
No, I have not heard of that actually.
Okay.
No.
Okay. Well, let me say this to you. I won 2 tickets on a show. Mm-hmm. One of the presenter show on this station. And so that's for myself to go.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering, I didn't know who else to bring, because every time I talk to people over here about what we're going through and everything, they're not really interested.
Okay.
It's only people on the south side that's interested and so on. So they might be blueprint for this thing. So yes. I was wondering if there was any of the ladies that wanted the ticket. That
well, yeah, I'll take a ticket, because I think by the time, I don't know what time the event is, but Dahlia and Moog's going back to Detroit. On Sunday.
Yes, unfortunately, we do leave Sunday.
Everything about the event. So, no worry yourself, because Brother Abu is on the Brother Ali Abu from Galaxy Radio is on the panel.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, so okay, you can have one of the tickets. Okay. Mm-hmm. Courtesy of myself and Galaxy Radio. Yeah.
Thank you.
I think they have the Empress Culture said that she left the envelope there with my name on it at the studio. So I would very much appreciate if you, as somebody from Galaxy or Nicaragua, could get that envelope and give the sister one of the tickets.
Thank you very much.
And there's one for myself. I'll be picking it up later on, yeah? So give thanks, respect to it. And it's a good show, yeah? Wonderful.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, brother. That is just awesome. Definitely. Why do I have to leave so early? It seems like everything is going on. I've heard, what is this, like the 4th event going on Sunday when I leave, or events happening after I leave? That's crazy.
Yeah.
I will say, to be honest, if I can be honest, I have seen some really, really cool stuff being here in London with all the different cultures and all the different people. It's beautiful.
I love it here.
I'm going to go home with a totally different mindset. Because even though I had a foundation, you know, when I came here, yeah, I had a foundation. I wanted all my people together and everything. But the way that I've seen it here culturally in London, it has been, it's just so beautiful, you know, to see everyone from everywhere. And to be honest, I don't want to say, you know, that Detroit is all bad, because I have just wonderful relationships with people there. It's beautiful. Yeah. But the amount of love that we got, like I said, I don't know if it's because we're American.
Mm.
But I'm going to be honest. I have gotten so much love from every
person.
Excuse me.
Africans.
African. Yeah. But everybody calls me the American here. I guess.
Because of your accent.
Because of my accent. Indeed. I consider myself not American. I've never called myself American until I came here, to be honest. True. It sounds weird to say it.
Yeah.
But that's how everyone else has been categorizing me here.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know if it's because I live in the States or not, but I've had more love and respect from a lot of the brothers and sisters that I've met here.
Yeah.
It's been amazing.
Okay.
Just the amount of just courtesy and hospitality. And I feel like genuine love.
Mm.
I feel like I've known you forever, Nessa, and I just met you.
Mm-mm.
So it's like at the end of the day, it's nice to see that abroad things are what I would like to see them as in Detroit.
You think it's a different energy as well?
Here. Absolutely. It's a different energy.
I always see it as like a fresh new energy rising up from the UK. That's why I think a lot of people are disappointed in the music that we're producing, because it's fresh and it's like, but we're still kind of like on this same frequency, the same vibe as the Americans, whereas we can actually just be unique and do our own stuff, and we'll actually make it if we stick together and support each other.
You want to know something? You know what you remind me of? When we were having a conversation the other day about that really, really ignorant girl,
Azalea Banks.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the horrible things she said about UK artists.
Mm.
But with what you just said, you technically said the same thing she said, but you said it in a better way.
In a better way.
Oh, and that's why I told you, sometimes it's not about the message itself, it's how you deliver it.
Right.
And she could have delivered that so much. She could have delivered that better and differently. And by the way, for anybody who doesn't know, she made horrible statements about UK artists, saying that UK artists are not... she's from like New York. Mm. She made horrible statements saying that UK artists are not creative,
yeah,
and like they didn't have talent, and they pretty much try to copy off everything off the States. And there's some...
And she said blackie, but she's black.
Yeah, yeah, she said other horrible things. But I don't remember everything that she said. But yeah, she said a lot of horrible stuff. Weird. But in so many words, she said the same thing you just said.
In a different way.
And yeah. I see that. Mm. Because there are some truly creative individuals here. All of the artists that I've met here are fabulous. And they truly have the music that can heal the world. And exactly. this unifying that we keep speaking of. This magnificent phenomenon that seems to never happen. Mm. It's like a folk tale or something, or a fairy tale.
Yeah.
But it can most certainly happen. Why do we have to unify when someone like Trayvon Martin gets killed, or Michael Brown? Why do we have to unify in tragedy? Why can't we unify just because it's a lovely day outside and we all want to break bread and eat together?
Exactly.
I don't understand why we can't do that. Why does someone have to die? That's just like with families. Mm. I don't know how it is here, like I said, because I never want to assume. But in the States, half of the time you only see your family during a funeral, because half of that family won't show up for a family reunion.
Well, it's like that with my family.
So why is that? You get some of your family members, nah, I ain't going to the family reunion, but they'll come to the funeral and eat all the food. I don't understand it.
Yeah.
I don't understand that.
Oh, is there going to be food there? Free food? I'm there.
So that's what I'm trying to understand. Why can't we come together just because? You have people like, you know, everybody, all the people that like to celebrate Christmas and all that stuff. Why do you have to have one day to do something, to unify? I don't get it. Yeah. Why can't we be like that every day? Why can't we be like that with a person that's walking down the street? Mm-hmm. Why can't we smile at one another? Why can't we hold hands? Why can't we help one another?
Why?
We could ask why so many ways and so many languages. And it just won't get us anywhere. Mm. That's why I said with what I do, I still have that soulful, clean music that people love. But when I realize that I'm inside of a, you know, here it's called grime. In the city, we call it trap and different things, you know, in Detroit. But when I'm in a club where all they want to hear is gangster music, how are they going to receive me? And what I found is a science to it.
Definitely.
I could say in a positive way, my sister, I need you to love yourself. Mm. I need you to grow and to do this and to that. But if I take that same message and I put it over an aggressive beat and I say it more aggressively, it's still the same message. Mm. It's just certain people receive things at a different frequency than others.
Yeah.
That's all it is. One is a lower frequency, one is a higher frequency. Yeah. But it's the exact same message. That's like saying tomato and tomato. It's the same thing. That's why I want people to understand, yes, some music you can't let your children listen to because of the curse words and things like that. But
awareness. That was good awareness, by the way.
Right.
Yeah.
But I still make sure that the content is there so that the person that I'm trying to reach, the person that loves, I've had people straight up tell me I'm ignorant. I love ignorant music. Yeah. They tell me this.
There are people, I think it was Lil Sims I was listening to. She was like, she was on radio, and I think it was in America, actually, but she's from the UK, and she was saying that, you know, she'll listen to her ignorant stuff, but it doesn't mean she's going to make it. But
she also probably has a stronger mind and can receive things differently. That's just like if you or I go out and they're playing music that we won't listen to in our homes, but we just kind of dance and we're partying.
But then that's the problem.
Everybody's mind can't handle that.
It can't handle it.
Everybody's mind can't handle that.
Some people are more sensitive than others.
Yeah, everybody's mind can't handle that. That's just the way it is. I have a song, a dance song that promotes world peace. Mm. But you think because I say, tip the waitress good, you think it's a party song, but the entire song is about world peace. Joining together in dance and song. But my thing is it's about taking a negative and flipping it into a positive. That's why one of my favorite artists is Kendrick Lamar, because he was able to do that. He won all these fans over, and then he came out. As far as I have other artists that I love that are not mainstream, but as far as mainstream, he's the first one I've seen in the newer generation do it successfully.
Okay, I've got a question now. How do we break the spell of hypnosis?
Of hypnosis?
Through music.
You can't.
You can't.
You cannot at all. And I'm going to tell you why. Because it's a magical tool. It's a spiritual tool. You cannot break hypnosis in music. Mm. You can't. Every time you're listening to something, right? Mm. Do you feel that in your spirit? Do you feel that in yourself?
Yeah, of course.
Then you can never break it. It's about what you put down into you. I'm not going to let everybody put their trash into my trash can. Mm. You can't break that. So what it is connect yourself spiritually to what you feel needs to be there.
So I think what it is now, because it seems like we ain't going to get anywhere with this whole uniting thing until
we can start with the music.
The big names, the big artists, mm-hmm. they actually come together mm-hmm. and they say, do you know what, we're not gonna do this anymore.
It's not gonna happen that way either. You wanna know why?
That's what
because
needs to
the big names are under control. It's gonna be an independent artist that rises
like
above.
J. Cole.
You have to be an independent artist to do it. Because at the end of the day, even with Kendrick Lamar and J. Cole, they still had to follow in line.
Yeah.
Just like I said, Kendrick Lamar had to create a first album to get popular, to put out what he really wanted to put out. A lot of artists have to break free. Look at, you know.
But why, I don't understand why a big art, why these artists wouldn't want to come together for the betterment of humanity when there's so much weather changes going on.
It'll make
right
their pockets
now.
Lighter. They won't be able to take those private jets. Yeah, they won't be able to shop at those stores
But they need to know that tomorrow we can all lose our lives because the world's not changing. Like, and this is what we need to address.
But you want to know what that mentality is, what they consider it? They consider that a poor mentality. They're rich, but they're not wealthy. To me, wealthy is up here.
Yeah.
So even though we want things to be a certain way, that doesn't mean that it's going to happen that way. Wealthy is, I feel, spiritually and
your
mentally.
Your health is your wealth.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
I'm not saying money. That's why I said it's a difference between rich, poor, and wealthy.
Yeah.
Wealthy, in my opinion, is spiritually and mentally. You feel what I mean?
Yeah.
So for us to have that, we need artists, all of us, you know, and if there's any artists listening, we need to make sure that we are distributing that wealth and everything that we create. You feel me? Because with them, they're rich. They look at us as poor, but we're not. And they don't want to think about unifying. They don't want to think about anything of that like that. They want to think about spending money and living their lives freely. They're not thinking about tomorrow. Clearly, because their actions show that. And if they did care about tomorrow, they would create different music.
Different music, yeah.
They don't care if we destroy ourselves as long as they can continue to slide their credit cards.
Okay, so what we need to do now is
we need to support our independent artist.
We need to do that. But what we also need to do is bring awareness to the community and let them know that what these artists are doing, so we don't support them.
Yes.
Because if we continue to support them, then it's like we're basically putting our next generation at risk.
Indeed.
Yeah, so that's what
we need to do. For example, when we left the city, Beyonce had just came to our city. And she sold out a stadium. Think about thousands of people. I mean, when you really think about it, thousands of people witnessing lies, spending hundreds of dollars. Some people probably hadn't even paid their light bill.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Just to receive trash within their spirit. And for me, I get it. You know, some people defended it. Oh, it's entertainment. It's just entertainment. It's only entertainment.
Yeah.
But that's not true. We hear some songs sometimes that make us happy. We listen to songs when we cry. We listen to songs when we want to party. Mm-hmm. Some people listen to songs that make them violent. It's not just entertainment.
Yeah.
And I think that's a big reason why Farrakhan wanted to bring, you know, quote unquote, all the hip hop artists together.
Right. Yeah.
Because he knew that they had power. They have
mm-hmm.
power, but they only have power because we give it to them.
Mm-hmm.
And because dollars are behind them. Because a person, you ever listen to a song that's completely garbage and then all of a sudden you're singing it?
Definitely.
The song is, that doesn't mean the song was ever good.
Subconscious mind.
No, the song was never good.
Yeah, definitely.
It's just they have the money to get the radio plays.
Yeah.
I don't listen to the radio.
Same.
I don't listen to the radio. Why? Because you're going to constantly be, and with the television and the radio, you're going to constantly be force-fed what people want you to have. So in order to bring awareness, one major way, to be honest, is through music. Because think about it. We're in a generation where everything is moving quickly. Some people don't even want to click on links to listen to music anymore. They only want videos. They want images. So in my mind, what I see is we need to produce images. We need to paint that picture because they're so blind. They need to see it. They say, okay, show me.
Yeah.
If I see it, I'll believe it. We need to put it in their face. Not just in their ears, but put it really in their face.
Yeah, no, definitely.
And show them this,
Vision is powerful. Image is powerful. Because once it goes into your brain, it's like, that's your world. You're locked into this into this world, and that becomes your reality, that becomes your focus.
That's just like, I don't necessarily believe in dreams. Mm. They're visions. So if you have these visuals that you constantly replay over and over into your mind, mm. you know, you need to make sure that you're putting the right things in there, yeah, spiritually, exactly. Things that will only help you, that will be conducive
and
to your growth.
And saying that as well, like, people, because I used to always think to myself, like, why is my life like this? But I didn't know. I didn't know that I had that power within. Mm-hmm. I didn't know. And I'm only just tapping into it now. Mm-hmm. So it's like, imagine, you know, how powerful we could be, you know, as females, not just as females, but as males as well. Because it's like, back in the days, you know, when in my teens, I used to watch TV. Like, I used to be a normal teenager. I used mm-hmm. to, you know, watch Easter. I don't know if you have your little soap operas. Or, yeah, you do. Like,
they have
EastEnders.
Well, they have them.
Oh. Yeah, we have EastEnders, we have all these things, and like, I used to watch those things like all the time. Like, how I remember, like, after school we'll be like, oh my gosh, we've got to go home, we've got to catch EastEnders. Mm-hmm. And it was just like, that was my reality, that was my way of life, that was my religion, like watching TV, being lazy, like I never used to do chores, like I just, you know, that was my life. But it's like now, it's like, I don't even watch TV anymore. But it's changed my focus, it's changed my reality so much. And it's like, people need to know that their brain is like a tool,
mm-hmm.
and it can do powerful things.
Indeed.
And they need to be careful of what they put into it.
I have a question for you. Mm-hmm. When you were saying, like, that was normal, that was the norm, that was your way of life.
Yeah.
Did you find yourself creating expectations or standards or building your morals around the things that you were watching? Like, you know, did you find yourself using those shows to define who you were? Or
yeah exactly,
because I felt that as well.
Yeah,
growing up, you know,
it's like you build a character.
Indeed.
Yeah.
And I think that also has a lot to do with why we treat our own the way that we treat our own. Mm-hmm. For example, like when I mentioned going into a room full of black people and mm. feeling nervous, mm. because a lot of that had to be what I saw. When you're constantly on television, they're constantly parading
yeah.
black people as enemy, black equals bad, even in the dictionary. Mm. You know what I mean? When you look at language, it's so powerful. That's why music is so powerful. So when every time you turn around, a person of a darker complexion, a person that contains melanin, they're always, you know, equal to something negative. Yeah. So it's like, if you see that all the time, that's embedded in you all the time, even how your parents mm. will say certain things to you
mm.
that even resembles that same, you know, thought process, it's very, yeah. very hard to break out of that. I can say successfully, because I know some poets who don't really cross over into the rap side,
mm.
who don't even really like going to the rap events because that same mentality, they're afraid that something may happen or the energy may be bad. And I'm not going to lie. Sometimes I'm walking through the valley when I go into those places.
Mm.
But when I go, I make sure that I have my spiritual armor on, mm. and I make sure that I am who I am, and I know that I am who I am.
Yeah.
So when I walk in there, nobody can deter me off of my path. They can't derail me.
Mm.
But when I also go, I am a prism of light, and I make sure that I reflect that in the room.
It. Yeah.
Absolutely. Okay. So I have so much respect from gangster rappers and trap rappers, just like I do poets, because I am the same no matter what.
Okay.
We got to know who we are to unify.
Thank you, Dahlia. You're tuning into Galaxy, the only deep brainwashing station. We're going to be playing you some Chronics soon. If you want to ask any questions, call in. The number is 079-23-334-515. And if you want to send a text,
something about you, girl, and I don't think it's just your smile. I don't know how to say it now, I've been thinking for a while. The best way to say it, woman, your energy is right, yeah. Before I hold you in my arms, I wanna hold you in my heart. Before we share our love up on that bed, I wanna place this crown up on your head, woman. But they're always trying your best. So when the whole world a crumble, your lion is alright. Before I hold you close,
just before hold you close.
Oh girl, I wanna let you know that when all is done and all is said, you deserve that crown upon your head. Say I'm in now, but me say Cleopatra, Queen of Sheba, Nefertiti, are you are your feature? Empress man in a beautiful creature. You summarize every queen of the East is out. Every night crawler and gully creeper. I'm in a no bow, no Mona Lisa. And but me know Venus and Serena, undisputed Queen Omega. Till Riverbank come to Riverbank's gang girl. All good to you now, no problem, girl. Kill a body, your physique, shot them. Whoa. Straight greens, don't visit Agpen. And the majesty, I eat a mad them. All bout, I make get up and I sing your anthem, girl. Cross my heart, say my pledge from when. I want Queen Star, all my love song them non-stop. I want Queen Star, all my love song them from top. And I want Queen Star, all my love song them ease up.
We back, like we never left ya.
Yeah.
Okay, so, Dahlia, all the way from Detroit, is going to do some nice spoken word for you now. Which spoken word piece are you going to do?
A piece that seemed to be so fitting on every day, but today is actually sunny.
Sunny.
The weather in London is bipolar, by the way. I've been trying to understand it. I don't know how to come out the house some days, but
yeah.
I have a lovely piece that I wrote when I was in a very dark time, and it was when I said, you know what? I want to embrace this as a learning experience. Mm. I'm tired. When you get tired, that's when you change.
Yes.
So that brings me to this piece, Dance in the Rain.
Okay.
They say it's not about if you can weather the storm, but if you can dance in the rain. Well, when the sky darkens and the thunder claps, that something in the rain seems to make me feel like it's all going to be okay. Reassuring and sweetly kissing my cheeks and rubbing my forehead, rocking me softly to sleep. Something in the rain seems to make me want to dance, sing, and shout. Those that don't know the struggle, they dread you, but I embrace you. I know what you're all about, I romance the thought of seeing you every day to watch you paint my windows with your tears instead of mine. I know that when rain comes, life continues, as it always does. Quenching the thirst within the turf that lies beneath my heels, I wiggle my toes in the soggy earth, finally feeling grounded, earthbound. When everything feels like it's boiling up, and to the point of boiling chaos, that dependable rain reminds me that life goes on. The purge, the cleanse, eradicating the old and vile and clearing the canvas for the fresh, the reassurance that even the deadest of things can still grow. I pretend that the showers wash away my iniquities. I watch myself shed a layer of filth and shed skin, an acid, peeling away at each layer of the onion, only to reveal a much more precious and fragile creature. The blessing of rain is so underrated. And if it did rain for 40 days and 40 nights, then maybe the eyes of the wicked will soon see the light other than being handicapped by selective sight. Oh, please shower me tonight, I want to witness this obsessive love that I possess for the rain. See, nights like these certainly made a believer out of me. See, I appreciate you, rain. I admire the fact that you're hated by so many, and yet you still come so faithfully just to fulfill your purpose tonight. Scattered showers in the forecast. I'm gonna put on my cotton dress with no undergarments and free my mind. I'm gonna leave all the toils of the day behind. I'm gonna take that step that appears a mile long, jumbled up as the hems of my gown clenched tightly within my fists. I'm gonna spin violently, stomp, and splash away my sins. No more waddling in sorrows. I'm ready to dance in the rain. Come with me. That's that piece.
Woo! That was nice, yeah. Thanks for that. All right, I'm thinking, which poem should I do now?
Oh, yeah, let's with some poetry.
I'm gonna back it up. Yeah, I think we need.
How do you say poetry? Say poetry.
Poetry.
Poetry. Say it again. Wait, say it one more time.
Poetry.
Okay,
now I'm just.
I'm trying to go home with like a fake accent, so I'm working on it.
Okay. Okay, I'm going to do some spoken word for you right now. Spoken word piece. And it goes like this. We dream. In the darkness, we fashion our thoughts. Then we create reality. From the same source of energy, so use it positively. Because if we neglect our thoughts, the nature of our being gets corrupted easily. This is for my single mothers who wake up every morning with a smile. Before your babies awake, you rise. The ones that master their emotions, all that sexual tension, months, years after your baby is born. You want to share that intimacy with the one you love, but the father of your child is missing, nowhere to be seen. Don't worry, sis. I say focus on your kids, or should I say little gods, because they are too precious to be called kids. We dream. See, I've actually forgotten the rest of the poem.
I'm going to tell you something. You didn't forget. A line that you said reminded me of a poet in Detroit, because I never forgot it. And when you said it, it was like, yo, that's awesome.
Oh, man.
Excellent poet. But there is one critique I must say. I hear kids.
No, I said...
She said, your kids, or should I say little guys, because they're too precious to be called kids. See, I remember.
Guys. Hey, you guys are doing very well, you know. But we don't really accept when ones like Harvey are addressing us as guys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But you know, guys are spies under disguise. Sometimes you see them are working a ship. You know, you see them and them have the guy as a career. You know what I mean? I say, so, it don't make sense addressing my brother as a guy or my sister as a little daddy. Real brothers and sisters, we need to be real. And that's what it's all about. Presentation. Mm-hmm. And your presentation has been wonderful this afternoon. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You know, as you can even recite, earth my body, water my blood, breath my wind, then fire my spirit. And then we can sing, earth my body, water my blood, breath my wind, then fire my spirit.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
And folks, just to remind you, you are listening to Galaxy 102.5 FM. De-brainwashing. Reclaim our Africanness. Earth my body, water my blood, breathe my wind, and fire my spirit. Yes, indeed, fam.
You said the fam quite nice. Yes, indeed.
I'm working on it.
Okay, so we're gonna go back into the topic now. We were just speaking, you know, about unity on a break, and we were thinking we didn't cover peace.
Indeed.
Because without peace, there'll be no unity.
Indeed.
People don't even greet one another when they're out in the streets.
No.
At all. What's that about?
Out on the streets, they call it murder.
Well, a lot of it is everyone is, you know, people automatically treat one another like enemies. Mm-hmm. That's one thing I can say I learned from the Detroit poetry scene. Because although Detroit has issues of its own, I found so much peace, literally, within the artistic scene. Because there were so many enlightened brothers and sisters that have passed down so many lessons to me.
Yeah.
I remember one thing that was taught to me. Because even as an artist, I was selfish. Mm. Not even just as a human being, but as an artist, I was even selfish. How can I spread these messages about love and peace, you know, when I don't even want to sit through someone else's poem? Mm. I was incredibly arrogant. And a poet said to me, you know, it's not always about you.
Yeah.
But he said it speaking to me as the lesson that he learned. He said, because that was one of the hardest lessons I had to learn as an artist. And I took that and was able to manifest that, create better art, become a better listener. And that made me a better person. It made me more patient with my brothers and sisters. It made me more patient with my children. It made me more patient in public. It just made me a better person. It made me shut my mouth when I wanted to get angry, when I wanted to curse someone out, you know, quote unquote, curse someone out. I found peace through my art, actually. I don't know. Some people, for people who aren't artists, you have to find a way to find peace within yourself and within your spirit. And you're not going to find that if you're all over the place and you're confused and you don't know who you are. How can you find peace with a stranger? You can,
it's true.
In your house, you can't. But what I can say is, through my art, I was able to find peace. And the first thing they taught me was saying peace in a greeting. Instead of hello, hey.
Peace. As-salamu alaykum.
Indeed. Alaykum salam. Right? I said it right, right?
Yeah. Alaykum salam.
And so once I got into saying that and speaking peace everywhere I went and realizing the power and manifestation and the things that I was saying, everything turned around full circle and I became a happier person. I became a person of peace and a mother of civilization.
Yeah.
And this being that was able to be a chameleon. I'm able to go anywhere and spread peace. But you have to first find that. And we can't educate brothers and sisters. We can't uplift them. We can't, you know, encourage them to love themselves and to be, you know, to walk in peace and virtue without first attaining that ourselves. I know some people that claim to be conscious, but will turn around and won't even try to stop a fight. They're the ones starting it.
Yeah,
it's true. I do consider some people out there are fake conscious people. Now, those are the people we need to call out. Call out the fake conscious people.
Think of one.
Calling out someone that's not conscious, that's a no-brainer because they know they're not conscious. So we're not doing anything by calling them out.
That's
a slap on the wrist. You know, that's nothing to them.
Yeah.
That's why we have to deliver. We have to, the word I want to say, we have to craft a package for them. It's a special package for them because, you know, they're a little disabled mentally. We got to help them get to where they need to be to receive our message because they're blinded. They're blinded, literally. So because they're spiritually blinded and mentally blinded, they technically are disabled. We need
they
to
need
help
guidance.
Them.
Guidance.
They need guidance.
Yeah, they need guidance.
Right. But as far as for like fake conscious people, those people we do need to call out. If they're not doing anything to help people, I'm not going to judge a brother that's not conscious because he just don't know no better. But a person that knows better, sometimes I had to be checked. Someone had to pull me by my coattails and say, you're straying, sister. You need to come back. This is your purpose. We need to bring peace in order to have that unity.
Do you think that religion unifies?
Religion tears people apart.
People. Okay.
Religion tears people apart, regardless of what anyone thinks, feels, or believe, whatever I think, feel, believe, whatever we were raised. The reason why religion tears people apart because there's no tolerance for other people of different beliefs.
Yeah. There's a lot of ignorant people, a lot of ignorant Christians.
There's no tolerance.
Muslims and ignorant, yeah.
And
they're not open-minded at all.
Exactly. So how can you claim peace in your faith when the first thing you're going to tell someone else that believes something differently from you is that they're going to go to hell? Or that they're going to go to this place or that place, or they're going to be punished.
Yes.
And I'm saying this not identifying myself at all at this point, because I'm not speaking about what I think, feel, or believe right now. But what I am going to say is you can be spiritual, and a lot of people believe different things. That's fine. I respect that. Because who am I to?
It might not be the religion. It might just be the people.
No, it's not the spiritual basis of the religion. It's religious practices.
Okay.
Not a person's faith per se. It's the religious practices and the attitudes that are formed. That's just like what I was saying to you. Mm. How do we reach people that are unconscious?
Okay.
Yes. It's the same thing like a preacher in a religion, just like I told you. You're talking to people in the church, they know why they're there. Mm. Why aren't you talking to the people on the street? Those are the people that you need to come in. So it's the same thing with the unconscious person. Right, it's the same thing.
You're right.
It's the same thing.
It's like, I know based on my experiences with a family member, I'm not going to say who in the family, but whenever I speak truth, it's like we're almost, it's like fire and water. We can't blend together. And it's really sad because sometimes I want to talk to her and it's like I try to. And the things that I say to her, it's like, I don't know, it might just be stress with work and, you know, the fact that she didn't grow up. Like with the things that I'm learning about now, she finds it hard to kind of like grasp. So it's like when I talk about it, it's like she just shuts me off completely and she doesn't talk to me.
Well, I'm going to tell you this.
At all.
A superior that worked with me, that works with me, I should say, in my, you know, normal day job. What he said to me made so much sense. He said, there's a way you say things and then there's a way you say things. And that is my whole basis. In order for us to promote peace and to unify people, the message cannot be delivered the same.
Definitely.
And it cannot be delivered through the same avenue either. Just like you got the tube and the train and the bus, all of those places, all of those modes of transportation can get you to your destination.
Yeah.
So if all of those modes of transportation can get you to the same destination, why can't we use different methods to get to the group of people or to the same destination. Definitely. Why can't we do that? It's the same thing. That's why I say I speak in metaphors a lot because everybody doesn't receive what I'm saying the same. Mm-hmm. Just like something I may have said, someone out there may feel offended or they may, because there's no peace in midst of confusion. Mm-hmm. So somebody may have misinterpreted something I may have said. That's why I keep saying the same thing in different ways, if you notice. Mm. This entire conversation, I've maintained my same stance. I have not changed my opinion. I've delivered it in different methods because psychologically, everybody can't process it the same. Mm. Not one time have I backtracked and said anything different. Mm. And that is a tool that we all need to acquire. Some people, or sheeple, I should say, they can't understand you if you're not saying bye, bye, bye. Mm. You may need to switch it up and say bye, 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 bam, boom, bam, bow. Some people might need it a little slower. It's the truth. Everybody receives it differently. No, and that's the message I want to get out there to all my brothers and sisters, is that you definitely get more bees with honey than you do with vinegar. We can keep delivering the same message. Do not change your message. Do not change your stance. Do not change what you know. Don't change that. But we have to get more creative with our methods of delivery. Yes. You can't wake the dead. Everybody's not the same. You can't wake them up the same. So we have to use different modes of transportation to get everyone to the same destination. That would be my message. That would be what I want to leave with everyone today. If you get anything else from Dahlia the Poet,
the thing is,
we got to use that.
When I listen to Farrakhan, for me, that's a base foundation in itself for any black person or even white person to listen to and grasp. It's not going into anything complicated for them not to understand, but it's whether or not they want to actually internalize it and actually, you know, make that change. Because when I was with my ex, for instance, and because he was a Rasta, but he knew Farrakhan, and he used to listen to a lot of his lectures. But when I played them in my home, he would, for instance, if we're upstairs, we'll run downstairs, or he'll just start arguments for no reason. And it's like, that person that's speaking is attacking your spirit and you don't like it. You don't like it.
Well, a lot of people don't, you know, when you have individuals like ourselves, you know, conscious people in general, we tend to be a mirror for others. So that's why a lot of people don't want to hear what we have to say, because we're forcing them to look at themselves.
Yeah.
And that's why, in my opinion, that's why I think a lot of people can't find peace and commit suicide, to be honest, is because they're tired of staring in that mirror every day. Because when you're forced to look at yourself, you have two options. You can change or you can stay the same. And if you don't want to make a change, you're just going to live in either being living in blindness or misery.
Exactly.
But I do have to mention one thing. How you were saying how, you know, the messages of Farrakhan, how it could be received, you know, from everyone. But that's the same thing in my point, modes of transportation. I know some people that think that he's radical. I know some people that, you know, disagree with some of the things that he says because they feel like it, you know, you got a lot of women who don't want to just cover up.
I get what you're saying.
They want to. I mean,
That's one of the.
It's a lot of different people that will have objections to things that Farrakhan says. Yeah. That's why I said.
But what I'm saying is the root. The root is there for people to actually take it.
But they're not going to because of the messenger. That's why I said we can deliver the same message together in this community in this conscious community, as we call it. We can deliver the same message over and over, but we have to use different modes of transportation because everybody just simply won't receive it. That's why
then they're just too comfortable. That's what it
yeah.
is. Too comfortable.
You don't want to rock your boat. You don't want to do that. If you've been coasting easy all this time,
but when something comes to make you uncomfortable, then that's when you're going to want
to
change.
You have to be forced to.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's why I say I got tired.
It's better to enforce it onto them because that's, you know.
But in what ways to enforce? Because people with rebellious spirits, the moment they feel enforcement, they feel oppressed, even though you're bringing them good news.
Good news. That's so true.
So
that is so true.
So that's why I said you need different modes of transportation.
Yeah. No, definitely. You're right.
If I came to you yelling at you in your face, pointing at you, saying so many positive things, they wouldn't sound so positive because of my tone.
And also, I think everyone needs sometimes validation from a different person, a different source.
Indeed. That's why I say it's different strokes for different folks, as they call it. You know, that's why I have one side of art where it's just a spoken word. I have sides where I may do things with jazz or soulful music because different people receive that differently.
Yeah.
Then I have the more aggressive stuff that I use for the people that I really want to reach because they're the people that this is the type of stuff they listen to all the time with no positive messages in it at all, with no story of growth in it at all. Telling a testimony is one thing, but if you're telling a testimony and you're not telling people how you overcame that, how you've healed, you're still in the same place.
Still in the same place.
And so how are you bringing peace to them and you don't have peace?
You're still kind of like attacking the emotions that are within.
You're just regurgitating them. It's just vomit on a track.
Exactly.
That's what it is. It's vomit. And our people deserve better than that, don't you think? Aren't
Definitely.
We better than, you know, you can find vomit in central London in a gutter somewhere off of side of a curb from some drunk person. You can find that anywhere. I don't want to go to sleep at night, you know, under hypnosis with vomit constantly being spewed into my ears. That's disgusting.
Okay, so I'm going to play a track for you guys right now.
You know, definitely.
Not guys.
Definitely enjoying London. I'm enjoying all the people. I'm learning so much. I really want to let everyone know that you are amazing.
What's the most thing that you've learned since you've been here?
I've learned that things are so much bigger than Detroit. That a lot of the issues that we face are not just native to home. They are abroad as well. And I'm also learning more about myself, learning more about I'm learning more about different struggles and things that people go through that I've seen personally. So, you know, and I'm also being a lot more thankful. I'm giving thanks a lot more for a lot of things that I took for granted.
Yes.
I can tell you that right now. There's a lot of things, as you know, in America, you take things for granted when you go somewhere else.
Okay, so we're going to end the show off right now with a beautiful track by myself, and it's produced by beautiful producer called Dwayne Patrick. And actually, he's another brother that's making good changes to the community right now, you know, with the ICANN project for children. You know, definitely positive movements. This is Catwoman.
Do you want to be free from captivity? My mind's gone wild. I'm about to lose this life. No place, no place in this reality for a Catwoman. For a Catwoman. Do you want to be free from captivity? My mind's going wild. I'm about to lose this life. No place, no place in this reality for a Catwoman. For a Catwoman.
And stop lying and stop telling the truth to the American people and to the world. And if you don't, your power as media is gradually being destroyed. You tried when you put Mr. Trump on television every minute of every day, questioning, hoping he would say something that would blow him out of the water. And every day he got stronger and stronger. That shows that your media is not working. So why not work it for good?
Yeah. You don't really wanna know what I've been through. I've been through too much, but I know you have to. When the going gets tough, though, what do you do? Take drugs. Does the cocaine really numb the pain? And the wheelie brings.
Where's Ness? Are you that?
When we can be the mastermind, is a weapon of peace and destruction. I'm heading for peace. I love Islam, but I hate stuck up, close minded humans. I wanna be free, free from captivity. But my band playing tricks. Am I always a driver when he's the best? No, I'm trying to realign with the stars while I can't leave.
From captivity, my mind's gone wild. I'm about to lose this life. No place, no place in this reality for a Catwoman. For a Catwoman. Do you wanna be free from captivity? My mind's gone wild. I'm about to lose this life. No place. No place in this reality for a Catwoman. For a Catwoman.
Do you wanna be free from captivity?
What a vibration is all good, family. Whenever time you tune in.
Whenever time you tune in to the only deep brainwashing station, it's all good. Yes, and it's been a wonderful vibrations this Friday afternoon. And Nessa, what you say, Nessa? What you say now? Honestly.
Thank you for the opportunity today, and I'm looking forward to, you know, discuss more topics for the community.
Yeah, it's all about our family from Detroit.
Michigan.
You're close. Yeah, you are to something. Don't think I won't get you out there soon. I'll get you out there soon enough.
Yeah, she's got my back for when I go over to Detroit now.
So it's the first time in England.
Yeah, this is my first time outside of Canada. I was like, whoa, everything is different. Everything.
Okay.
But like I mentioned before, this experience has been beautiful because culturally, and as a black person, I personally don't know my family lineage. And to see people and they know where they come from, they know what countries.
You got to know.
It's a beautiful thing. And it's mind-blowing for me.
The best thing is to seek the waters.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because it's what we do. We pour libations.
Indeed.
Unto our ancestors, we wake up in the morning, we crave for waters. You know, our body full of a percentage of waters.
Mm-hmm.
The earth is surrounded with the waters. So it's very important. You know, when we get a glass of water, that it is still pure and natural.
Indeed.
One can accept with a lot of acceptance. All right? Mm-hmm. So give thanks. What do you say, brother?
Hey, thank you for this opportunity. This is like...
Okay, I hear something. Yeah.
I said, thank you for this opportunity, man. I never, you know, experienced anything like this, and this is really mind-blowing, you know.
You never experienced anything like this?
No, not at all. Not from where I come from. Not from where I come from.
Oh, my word.
You know, this is something big to me. You know, I really... You guys open my eyes to a lot
you
of
say
things.
You guys.
Excuse me.
We're serious, man, because, you know, even my sons, my 27-year-old son, pops, I refuse to be violated.
I trust me. I don't like violations.
It's definitely a retraining of things. Cleansing.
Just that right there, you know. That just, you know, it's just that little thing right there.
Just reclaim.
Makes you know.
Just reclaim our Africanness.
Yes, sir.
That's all we need to do. Do our best.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's what we need to do. Our best. You know, we like that African expression. Mm. Strong and bold.
Yes, sir.
You know, and the attire, the clothing.
Indeed.
The looks, the shape.
Indeed.
You know what I say? Good tidings, family. Most swagger feature, two more, and then we give thanks.